We always say to guests when we welcome them, welcome to my office and point out to the sea.
Being a diving instructor down here in Masa Alam, it doesn't feel like a job at all. It's a passion.
For us, it's the best job in the world.
If you have never dived before and you're going to go for the first time, the Red Sea is actually amazing. It's a different world. You see the colors of the reef, red, orange, green, purple. It's amazing. I cannot describe it. You have to do it.
The marine life in Mars Alam is famous for turtle, sea cow, and the sharks. They come close to tease you.
Sometimes I feel my heartbeat going up when I see a shark. It's like, oh my God, look at that. You have to focus on that moment. You have no time to think about anything else. And I think that's the special part. Being an instructor is something so special.
It's the bond underwater, the trust, the adventure, sharing moments together in a deeper level than the normal daily routine.
Usually I don't take my suit off, I just wait for the next dive.
As divers, we are passionate about marine life, about the environment, about what we see and feel.
I think if you go in the water for the first time and you see what you have underwater, then you start protecting it anyway, because you want to see it growing.
Oof, look at the crab. I've dived all over the world, but what keeps me coming back to Mars Alam is the mixture of so many things to see, so many things to do.
Oh, Peggy's having a bath! Peggy's having a bath!
Get up!
Don't ruin me, eh?
Let me do it!
Don't hurt it.
I'm not gonna hurt it.
Don't hurt it, it's alive. I'll bite you.
No!
Oh, cut me now. No more. No more. Do you want to watch your film?
It is difficult to bring my children up into a world that where money's hard to come by. They do mean the world to me. And to give them the life that I want to give them, I can't at the moment.
Alright, are we going to do what we said then?
Yeah.
First one upstairs wins.
As a child, I saw people knocking at the door for money off my parents. The moment that it hits you and you realise that's happening to you and your family, it's not a good feeling. When a bailiff knocked at my door for money that we owed, my youngest child stood there grasping a teddy, saying, "Mummy, she's not coming to take my teddy."
Mum, she was just tickling my foot.
Right, listen, are we going to do it then or what?
This is a mushroom, a 6-foot mushroom that you can surf. Less people have ridden a mushroom surfboard than have been to the moon. It's hard to call ourselves the world's leading mushroom surfboard builders because we're the only ones willing to do it.
Basically, we wanted to make the most sustainable board on the planet.
If you look at the surf industry on a whole, we have a problem. A traditional surfboard is toxic. It is a petroleum-based foam that is open cell. So said board breaks, it will leach microtoxins into the environment.
Without a healthy ocean, there would be no life on Earth. And ocean's under extreme threat from human impact, from carbon emissions, from climate change, from plastic pollution, through just human waste getting in the ocean. And we can clean that up, and we need to clean it up really fast.
We're not at the point where we can just sustain this anymore. We need to fix it. We need to move forward, and we need to regenerate the problems that have been left to us.
We might only replace 200 polyester boards a year, but that's 200 boards that aren't going to be here for 50,000 years.
We figured the only way to really get into the industry is to rattle the cage a little bit and do something that the big guys, it's not even on their radar, do something outside of the box.
We started in a garage. We were two blocks off the beach.
You want to be able to stay on site and focus all your energy to one task.
The garage is the place where you're free to fail. You know, you close that door and no one has a clue that I'm growing a mushroom surfboard in there. It's just another garage. It's a mushroom, but it's not your grocery store mushroom.
Mushrooms are nature's recyclers and repair mechanism. We can use mushrooms to clean up oil spills, to clean up toxic waste, even nuclear waste, and to help everything grow faster. So the mushroom surfboard is a brilliant example of how we can actually repair and regenerate Earth's ecosystems.
Mycelium is the root of the mushroom, and it needs moisture and nutrients just like anything else, particularly darkness, and it needs that environment constantly. Mycelium grows very tight, like a fiber.
It's been genetically designed to be an organic growing machine.
The technology is barely being explored. There's endless applications. This is a perfect alternative for anything that would be expanded polystyrene, basically, your basic styrofoam.
We grew around 20 of them. Each one, we learned something else. Growing one big was the first challenge. While it's growing, it's alive, and it starts eating the material and replacing it with the white space, which is here. 2 years of experimenting, several thousand dollars, hundreds and hundreds of hours of time, and every time we opened the box, it was just a mystery as to what was gonna be. There would be clover, like, in your garden, just all clover, no mushroom surfboard at all. Then we had to go from taking a mushy, big, moist lump and putting it into a dehydrator. I broke one in half trying to put it into the box by myself.
There's nothing better, I guess, than failure for innovation.
The first generation one was
proof of concept.
It was proof of concept. It was ugly, it was heavy. And then when we finally got one, that's when Dan had to take the ropes.
I hand routed and hand sanded basically everything, because if you machine sand, you run the risk of burning through on some spots, and we didn't have the luxury of another blank. I had one shot at this. If you were to break it in the ocean, it biodegrades. The resin would become innate, so it would just turn into sand essentially. And the actual core, anybody can eat it. The innovation of the actual mushroom surfboard was not just us. It was a collaboration and a huge effort from multiple people and multiple companies.
Just making one surfboard creates a ton of waste. There's all these throwaway materials. What do you do with the fiberglass? What do you do with the excess resin? What do you do with the stir sticks, the brushes? Every single thing made to make that board is trash. It inevitably ends up in a landfill. If you go into my shop now, everything that you make a board with, there's a bin for it. I'm proving that, cool, I can do this. Why can't other shops do it? I mean, if you're a surfer, how do you not want to help a place become zero waste? So I got emailed a video of these mealworms devouring foam. It was time lapse. I had never heard anything like that, and I thought it was CGI. And that was Eddie Garcia and his Living Earth system.
We take a surfboard, we put it with 5,000 worms, we have the 5,000 worms pretty much chew on it, we put it through a screening system. After the screening system, it gets treated with a mycelium, same thing that they're building the surfboard with. And all these things together, through a course of 3 months, are bringing it full circle back into 100% organic, nutritious fertilizer, basically. And that's sort of the process of how it works. So about 5,000 worms will break a board down in about a week. This should be a launch ramp for the larger municipal industries, restaurants. There's a lot of waste that comes in the form of EPS styrofoam. It stays on the planet for 3,000 years. It's a huge problem on the planet right now. So what better way than be able to launch it through the surf industry and the cool factor that we have with it? California actually just took surfing as the official sport of the state. So most kids in California, they want to learn to surf. So what better way to inspire them to think out of the box than through surfing?
That's the thing with EcoBoards, they've got to be just as good as their traditional toxic counterpart.
So in 2017, there were 60,000 EcoBoards that we verified made globally by over 150 board builders in 25 different countries. It's taking off around the world now.
We're invited to donate our first mushroom surfboard to the Surfing Heritage Museum. It's
the Hall of Fame of surfing for board builders.
Wow, look at these, Dan.
Welcome to the Surfing Heritage.
Nice to meet you, sir.
It's amazing that this is completely 100% biodegradable. Who would have thought mushrooms, surfboard? This is the future. We're honored to be the first museum to be able to show a product like this. It's not just good for California, it's good for the whole world.
I don't want to say it's validation, but what are we going to do to set the stage for the rest of the world? And I do believe because of the diversity that's here in California, we should be the leaders and the innovators. We should change the status quo of what we're so used to, because what we're so used to hasn't really worked.
Pro surfers are winning world championship events on eco boards, and everybody who's riding them can't tell a difference. So why wouldn't we do it?
There's not really a change in performance between a standard board to an eco board because the technology is so advanced now. I think the cool part is the fact that you know what's going into your board and that it's helping the environment opposed to hurting it.
If you haven't surfed yet, go do it. It's soul-changing.
Surfing is the closest thing to, I guess, the dream of flying. It's hydro flying, basically. You get to express yourself however you want. There's no wrong way to do it. You're painting away.
We put everything we had into getting this far, and to have it here in our hands, having surfed it, having built a company around it.
We're very proud of the fact that we grew a surfboard
out of this.
আমাদের বাড়ির পাশে লাইন আছে, তো তাই জন্য আমাদের অনেক সম্মুখীন হতে হয়, কারণ আমাদের এখানে খুব মানে বিপজ্জনক ঘটনা ঘটে। এক্সাম্পল, অনেকজন মারা যায়, কেটে যায়, এর জন্য আমাদের অনেক বিপদের সম্মুখীন হতে হয়। আমাদের বাড়ির লোকেদের সাথেও এটা হয়েছে যে আমাদের এর কারণে, এই অ্যাক্সিডেন্টের কারণে মারা গেছে। মানে আমার বাবা পুরো দুটো হয়ে গেছিলো। বাবা অ্যাক্সিডেন্ট হওয়ার পরে আমার লাইফটা পুরো চেঞ্জ হয়ে গেছিলো। পড়াশোনায় মনোযোগ দিতে পারিনি, কিছুই করতে পারিনি। আমার বাবার অ্যাক্সিডেন্টটা হলো, যেই দিন ফার্স্ট অ্যাক্সিডেন্ট হলো সেই দিন আমার মাধ্যমিক পরীক্ষা স্টার্ট। যেই দিন বাবা অ্যাক্সিডেন্টটা হয়েছিল সেই দিন আমার পরীক্ষা ভালো হয়নি। আমি জাস্ট ব্ল্যাক মানে খাতা শুধু সাদা পেজ দিয়েই চলে এসেছিলাম মাধ্যমিক পরীক্ষার সময়।
Very few of the people here are veteran activists. These are grandparents and young people, people who never would have considered themselves environmentalists, but now really feel they have no other option.
Looks like we're in for stormy weather. One night's
have been five mass extinctions in the past. The one that everyone's heard of is the extinction of the dinosaurs, which was 65 million years ago. Species do go extinct all the time. What's happening now is that that's happening at a much, much higher rate than it normally happens, and that's because of human activity. I'm a conservation scientist, so I have a PhD in biodiversity management. I'm interested in finding solutions to our ecological crisis. As we can see behind me, we have a scientist tent here at Extinction Rebellion. This is manned by a group called Scientists for Extinction Rebellion, a group of like-minded scientists who, like me, are concerned for the planet and feel that one of the things that they could do, other than rebelling, is by providing an information resource for fellow rebels.
Part of our role is really to back up the demands that Extinction Rebellion are putting on the agenda, and that is, yes, this is in line with science, this is in line with scientific evidence. But our role is also here to say, as scientists, we've been sort of ringing the alarm for years and decades, really, and there's been no political response. Political leaders have really failed to act upon this evidence.
The politicians, the decision makers, haven't been listening to us.
So it's now time for scientists to say, okay, we have to go to the next level and see other ways of making people act on this message. And I think civil disobedience and non-violent direct action is such a way.
As a scientist, I have very little access to decision makers because decision makers aren't listening to me. And this is our last throw of the dice. I'm desperate, you know, there's nothing else we can do. So, and that's why we've taken to the streets.
I work from 6 in the morning to 6 p.m. So I spent most of my time with Sudan. Sudan. First of all, before any activity, I have to check on Sudan. How he spent a night, if he's in good body condition, if he's healthy. Sudan is the most wonderful rhino. I've never met a rhino very gentle like Sudan, and it's also my great friend of mine.
Good boy.
The way I treat myself right now is just I don't treat myself as a human. I am half human, half rhino. During the day, when the climate is hot, we help him to apply mud on his body to cool body temperature down.
Does he like it?
Yeah, he like that. And normally rhinos, they do mud bath, but because of his old age, he can't do it regularly. That's why we help him to apply mud on his body. Sit down. This is Sudan's bed. I'm just leveling where Sudan used to spend his time when he's resting here. I'm really taking great care of Sudan. Just like human elderly people.
I'm doing a regular checkup. I would routinely just do full body examination. I'm looking at whether they also have some parasites in them, like ticks and flies. So, and in this case, none is present. he is well looked after because of the situation. I wouldn't say he's pampered. Perhaps he's only, it looks like he's pampered because he is the only northern white rhino male remaining that we know of. There's a lot of attention that he attracts from tourists, media, international media, local media.
This is not a Kodak moment.
He doesn't move that fast. He lies down quite a lot during the day. He might, God forbid, catch an infection that will bring him down.
He's 43 right now, and a rhino can normally live up to 40 years in the wild. He's doing fine, but I'm much worried. Anything might happen at any time.
Mike, Bravo, Mike, Bravo, Mike, what?
Mike, what?
Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what? Mike, what?